Hello again, this is Khaled Mustafa Ahmed, and I'm going to continue the discussion about Kerberizing network file system version 4. In the previous sessions, we have already discussed how to do that under Fedora 26. And during that sessions, we have seen that we need to create the users and groups for the user participating in this scenario on every client workstation on our LAN. And then let the KDC authenticate this user before allowing or denying them using their corresponding network file system shares. Also, we seen that we need to manually edit the file system table file on every client workstation to let the exported file system automatically been mounted on this machine at boot time. This will put some administrative burdens on the system and network administrator who used to manage this network. And that could be acceptable for small LAN, but not for intermediate to large ones. It will become a real nightmare for system administrators. So what we should do? Is there anything we can do to improve this situation? Is there any way for centralizing the creation and administration of the user accounts and the groups? Is there any way for centralizing some administrative tasks? The answer is simply yes, just by including the 389 directory server to our network. The 389 directory server, previously called the Fedora directory server, is an LDAP server developed by Red Hat as part of Red Hat's community-supported Fedora projects. The 389 directory server provides the following key features: multi-master replication, which provides highly available directory service for both read and write operation, chaining and referrals, increase the power of the directory by storing a complete logical view of the directory on single server while maintaining the data on number of directory server transparently for clients. Roles and class of service provides a flexible mechanism for grouping and sharing attributes between entries dynamically. Efficient access control mechanism provides support for macros that dramatically reduce the number of access control statements used in the directory and increase the scalability of access control evaluation. Resource limit by bind the N grants the power to control the amount of server resources allocated to search operation based on the bind-n of the client. Multiple databases provides a simple way of breaking down the directory data to simplify the implementation of replication and chaining in the directory service. Password policy and account lookout defined set of rules that govern how password and user accounts are managed in the directory server. Support TLS, which provides secure authentication and communication over the network using the Mozilla Network Security Service libraries for cryptography. Support LDAP client authentication through the simple authentication and security layer, which is an alternative to TLS SSL, and it's a native way for some application to share the information securely. The SASL, or the Simple Authentication and Security Layer framework, allow different mechanisms to be used to authenticate a user to a server, depending on what mechanism is enabled in both client and server applications. SASL also create a layer for encrypted sessions, and using the GSS API Directory server utilizes Kerberos tickets to authenticate sessions and encrypt data.
The major components of the directory server include the following: NLDAP server, which is a version 3 compliant network daemon, directory server console, which is a graphical management console that dramatically reduces the effort of setting up and maintaining the directory service, and SNMP agent, which could be used for monitoring the directory server using simple network management protocol.
Here, as shown in the figure, the directory server console provides you a user interface that can be used to connect to the admin server. Actually, we use this console to manage the admin server that will in turn be used to manage the directory server. The admin server process the configuration requests for the directory server instances and perform many common server tasks, such as stopping and starting the server instances. Directory services are usually divided into two database categories: the configuration databases, which stores the console and the admin server settings and some of the directory server configuration. The user databases contain the user and group information.
Okay, before starting the installation and configuration of the 389 directory server, I want to give you some quick overview about OpenLDAP and the directory server. But I am quite confident that you already have a good knowledge and understanding of what OpenLDAP is, and you are able to perform some administrative tasks on OpenLDAP good enough to keep you going by referring to the OpenLDAP documentation and other material about OpenLDAP on the internet. But if you are fairly new to the OpenLDAP, this overview may help you to understand some of the important terminologies commonly used in the LDAP domain. Okay, LDAP stands for Lightweight Directory Access Protocol. It's just a network protocol for LDAP clients to use for accessing the LDAP directory server. The directory server itself is simply a data store that contains a specialized database used for storing attribute-based information in a tree-like hierarchy called DIT, or Data Information Tree. The information in the directory is generally read much more often than it is written, and as a consequence, directories don't typically implement the complicated transaction or rollback algorithms that relational databases uses for doing high volume complex update. Directories are tuned to give quick response to high volume lookup or search operation. Also, it might be able to replicate information widely in order to increase the availability and reliability while reducing the response time. When directory information is replicated, temporary inconsistencies between the replicas are considered acceptable, since it eventually gets synced. The LDAP directory service is based on a client-server model, where one or more LDAP server contain the data that making up the LDAP directory tree. An LDAP client application connects to an LDAP server using the LDAP APIs and asks it a question. The servers then respond with the answer or with a pointer to where the application can get the answer, which is typically another LDAP server. with properly constructed namespace, no matter which LDAP server an application connects to, it always sees the same view of the directory tree. A name presented to one LDAP server references the same entry it would be at another LDAP server. This is an important feature of a global directory service which LDAP directory server can provide. An example of attribute-based information are employees' information in a company or user profiles in a computing environment, network resources, address book, phone book, or even items in a bookstore. And as we said before, the directory server database is optimized for read and search operations much more than writing and updating operations. When you create an entry in a DET, its data contents are contained in attributes, which are grouped into object classes, which are packaged into schemas. Everything in LDAP is hierarchical, so also the object, so also with object classes and attributes. Schemas are just packaging units that roughly group together related object classes and attributes. All object classes and attributes are defined inside schemas, but there are also some object classes and attributes defined as being operational, which are embedded in the LDAP server software and do not need an external definition. All schemas which include the object classes and attributes used in any LDAP implementation must be known to the LDAP server. The object classes, on the other hand, are just containers that group together the related attributes, which we use to define and create entries on the directory tree. It also defines the way how we use this attribute when constructing the entries. I mean, whether an attribute must be specified or it may be specified within newly created entries that include such object class. Object classes may be organized in hierarchy, in which case they inherit all the properties of their parents or superior object class in the LDAP jargons. Actually, we have three types of object classes. The first type is the structural object class, which must be used to create entries or data objects. The second type is the auxiliary object class, which may be added into any convenient entry. The third type of object class is the abstract object class, which is just a definition of what object class is. And the most common abstract object class is the top object class, which forms the highest level of every object class hierarchy, and it terminates any hierarchy. If an object class is part of hierarchy, it must be the same type, means structural or auxiliary, as its superior object class. The exception to this rule is if the superior is the top abstract type, which, as noted, is used to terminate the hierarchy. Object classes are the means for including attributes to our data entries. Object classes define whether an attribute is mandatory, must be present, or optional, which may be present within the object class.
Now let's talk a little bit about attributes. Attributes are typically where data units get stored. Attributes must be defined in some schema, and every attribute must be included in one or more object class. To use an attribute in an entry, its object class must be included in the entry definition, and its object class must be specified in a schema, which must be identified to the LDAP server. Attributes can appear once in an entry if it is flagged as a single value in the attribute definition. Also, it can appear more than once if it's flagged as multi-valued in its definition. But in case not stated, the default is multi-value. For example, it's perfectly reasonable to have more than one instance of an entry email attribute. But it would be slightly confusing to have more than one instance of the user password attribute in some entry. An attribute definition may be part of a hierarchy, in which case it inherits all the properties of its parent. An example, the common name or given name or surname attributes are all children of the name attribute. But unlike object class, attribute hierarchies are not terminated as the case with object classes. In the attribute case, it is the absence of the superior definition which indicate this is the end of the hierarchy. Also, an attribute definition include its type or syntax. For example, an attribute can represent string or number or boolean and so on. The dot number corresponding to its syntax is what to tell the LDAP directory what kind of information the attribute actually represent. The definition also includes how it behaves in certain conditions, like whether the comparison operations are case sensitive or not, using what's called matching rules. Entries. Entries are just group sets of object classes within a DAT. Every entry must contain one and only one structural object class. But usually, structural object class may have superior one that inherit from, which also can have a superior, and so on to the top. This hierarchy may be viewed as a single structural object class. Entries may also include any number of auxiliary object classes if their attributes are needed in an entry definition. Entries can have child entries, which appears just below them in the hierarchy. Entries can have also parent entries, which appear just above them in the hierarchy, and also can have sibling entries the same level as them in the hierarchy. Actually, we have three types of entries. The first is an object entry. This is the most common entry type. It contains the data which stored in attributes from the included object class. The second type is the alias entry,
which include only the alias object class that have only one attribute called alias object name. The third type is the sub-entry type, which is used to store administrative or operational data related to its parent. The following diagram illustrates some of these entries' relationships. Here in the diagram we have at the top we have the root or the suffix of our dead tree, and right below it we have some entry that have some child entries. The entry itself include one structural object class that inherit from some superior one, and also include some auxiliary object class. The attributes from all of these object classes are used to define the data inside the entry. During the directory server setup, we create a root for our dead tree, which is called the suffix of the tree. And at that time, we have chance to name it the way we like. But it is usually named the same as your company or organizational domain name. Also, a couple of organizational units for peoples, groups, and other are created automatically for us by the setup script. And of course, we can add more units of different types after finishing with the directory server setup. These organizational units, or OUs, are just containers for grouping similar objects under the related nodes or branch points. For example, our company employees could be created under the people organizational unit, while sales group or developer group can be created under the group's organizational unit. And you are free to create and add as many units as you want to suit your needs, and also to branch down your dead tree to match your company or your organization division style, as you may see fit. The OU itself, which represent a branch point on a dead tree, consists of a structural object class named organizational unit that include only the OU attribute, and of course the abstract object class top, which is used to terminate the object class hierarchy. To create any data node on the dead tree, you need to include one and only one structural object class. You can also include as many auxiliary object classes as you want to the node you want to create. Another example of directory tree, as we see here, it consists of the directory suffix or directory root, which includes the domain object class that have only one attribute called DC or domain component. This attribute is flagged as multi-valued in its definition, and that's why you are able to use it multiple times in the suffix node. Right below the suffix we have the people organizational unit that include the organizational unit object class, which has the OU attribute. And right below it we create our user or our company employees. The same thing for the groups organizational unit, where we create two groups right below it, one for the engineering sector and another group for the sales sector. And this leaves must include the object class required to create it. For example, to create a user under people organizational unit, we need to include the person, the organizational person, the init org person, and the POSIX account object class. Since we need the attribute from all these object classes in our entry definition and so on. We refer to entries by their attributes. This means that each entry must have at least one attribute that is unambiguously referred to it at its level in the DIT tree. This attribute is called the entry relative distinguished name or the entry RDN, and it functions like file name in your file system. To refer to an entry unambiguously, you use the entry RDN combined with all of its parent entries RDN, and this chain of RDNs, which leads to the top of the tree, provides an ambiguous path to the entry in question. We call this chain of RDNs the entry distinguished name or the entry DN. You must specify the entry DN during its creation so that the LDAP system knows where to place the new entry, and make sure that the entry DN and the entry RDN is not being already used by another entry. For example, the distinguished name for user Tariq on our DIT tree could be stated as UID equal Tariq, comma OU equal people, comma DC Khaled MAE, comma DC equal local. And of course, his RDN is UID equal Tariq. Okay. The last thing I like to mention here before finishing up with this quick introduction is about what's called LDIF. LDIF stands for LDAP Data Interchange Format, which is a text format for representing LDAP data and commands. It is the standard way for writing data to the LDAP directories and even added delete or modify operation on already existing data entries. When using an LDAP system, you will likely use the LDIF format to specify your data and the changes you wish to make to the LDAP DIT. LDIF is meant to be able to describe any entry within the LDAP system, as well as any modification that must take place. Using LDIF, LDAP changes are simply written within some text file with an arbitrary name and then fed into the LDAP system using one of the available LDAP management commands like LDAP added or LDAP modify. LDIF works using the basic key value system with one statement per line. The key is on the left hand side of the line, followed by colon and space. The space is important for the line to be read correctly. The value is then assigned on the right side. This format works well for LDAP's attribute heavy syntax, but can also be used to issue commands and provide instruction on how the content should be interpreted. Multiple lines can be used to provide long values for some attribute by beginning the extra lines with a single space. LDAP then will join these lines when processing the entry. Okay, I guess it's enough theory at the moment, but I will continue the discussion about the LDAP and the various LDAP client tools like LDAP search and LDAP modify. But just after installing the 389 directory server. Okay, this is the end of this session. If you have any issues about this video, please comment me to let me know. Thank you for watching and goodbye.